In the past 30 seconds, you have just seen the results of 2 years of astrophotography, or at least as much of the results of the past 2 years as I could squeeze into 30 seconds. And do you know what every one of those images has in common? Every sub is 60 seconds long. Is it that 60 seconds is a magic number? No, it isn't. But there is something about that 60 seconds that is very relevant to today's topic. How long should you shoot your subs for? I'm going to begin addressing this topic by sharing a few things here, doubtless going to think are unusual at the very least. So there are some great calculators out there you can find online that you can use to look at things such as your present bortle, your telescope, maybe even factor that in with other sky conditions, and they will give you suggestions for exposure times. I don't use any of them, never have. There's also some great suggestions out there based on regular photography that you should increase your exposure time and perhaps your gain until the light curve on your histogram shows a complete bell curve, a little away from the left side of the histogram, not quite touching it. I never bother with that, and I mean I never bother with that. And there's been advice that you need to make your subs longer in order to deal with things like read noise. So noise isn't really much of an issue in modern astrophotography. It is so manageable that it's still relevant, but on a scale of 1 to 10, I would place it near the bottom of that list, a 9 or a 10. And I imagine some of you are already thinking I'm crazy, which is why I started out this video showing you much of the last 2 years' worth of astrophotography that I've done using these principles. All right, let's take a moment and I'll explain the rationale for this madness. So, let's look at why I don't bother with exposure time calculators. The shorter answer is because this is astrophotography, not photography. Exposure time is not really a relevant factor here, or at least not in the way it is with regular photography. If I'm shooting regular photography, I'm getting one shot per frame, and I have to factor in how the exposure time is going to affect that shot. For example, if I wanted to photograph a hummingbird, I have to consider if I want to illustrate how fast its wings are beating. If I wanted its wings to appear somewhat of a blur, I would use a slower shutter speed. But if I wanted its wings to appear sharp and crisp, then I would use a very fast shutter speed to capture only a narrow sliver of time during which those wings are in rapid motion. And in either case, I'm getting one frame per shot. So in such cases, shutter speed becomes very relevant. But such considerations are irrelevant in astrophotography, especially if you're shooting deep sky objects. Your subject of interest isn't going anywhere, and while it is in motion, a great deal of motion and moving very fast, at least if you perceived it from up close, from our perspective, light years away, sometimes hundreds, thousands, or even millions of light years away. The subject is essentially motionless. It's not going anywhere, so shutter speed doesn't matter. So what about the myth that the entire light curve on your histogram needs to be showing and that the left side of the light curve should be not quite touching the left side of the histogram? I'm going to tell you conclusively right now that is not true. How do I know? Well, there's a couple things. For one, ask yourself, how does the histogram tool know what the dimmest sources of light are in the region that you're trying to image? It doesn't. It's just an algorithm presenting you exposure information in a graphical form. It doesn't know what it is that you're trying to shoot, and it doesn't know what the dimmest structures within that image are. It simply looks at the light values that it is aware of and creates a histogram from that, a light curve. So don't make the mistake of thinking that when you shoot astrophotography and you look at your histogram, if the left side of the light curve seems like it's coming up against the left side of the histogram box, that means that you're not capturing all the information. The histogram tool has no idea what it is that you're imaging, nor whether or not you've exposed long enough to capture all of it. All it can really tell you is whether or not you've blown out some of the information, which means that some parts of the structure you have imaged are so overexposed that there is no high-frequency detail conserved within that area, or, in other words, the structure is washed out entirely by the brightness. So, with astrophotography, what really matters is that the light curve isn't clipped on the right, because that would mean that you're blowing out areas. And if that is the case, then you have to reduce either your exposure time or your gain. Usually, preferably, once you find what I think of as prime exposure time, you would adjust your gain. We'll come back to that later. And there is yet another reason why it's always good to go with as short a subframe exposure time as possible. If your exposure times are short and your gain is well managed, then your subframes will retain all their information even when shooting DSOs notorious for areas of very high brightness and very dim areas. In other words, high dynamic range structures. Think of a camera sensor as a collection of cups, and photons are water molecules that fall into the cups. The more exposure time you have on a target, the more time there is for water molecules to fall into each of those cups. Though in this case, it's photons falling into photosites. Now, imagine that each one of those cups gets brighter and brighter as more and more water falls into it. When a cup is entirely full, it becomes entirely bright. It can't show any of the shading that allows for the presentation of fine detail. When photosites fill up on a sensor like this, we say that the image they produce is blown out. All the detail information contained on the sensor is drowned out by light. If your subframe exposure times are long, you run a higher risk of blowing out photosites. If your subframe exposure times are shorter, there's less time for the photosites to fill up with photons, meaning information does not get blown out. Yet another reason it's better to shoot short subframe exposure times. And there are quite a few other advantages to short exposure time subframes. If a subframe happens to be ruined by cloud, you can discard it without losing much information. And subframes don't suffer as much from guiding errors because they have less time to be influenced by them. And if other things happen, such as multiple satellites passing in front of a subframe causing you to discard it, then like with clouds, you're only losing a little information. So, after all of that, I'm sure you're wondering, alright, so what is the best subframe exposure time? And the answer is, as little as possible, just enough to reveal the detail within an image. Detail must be revealed in each sub in order that the sub can be graded. People use different strategies for grading subs, but for myself, I give them a visual inspection first to make sure there are no obvious problems such as clouds blocking the images, and then I run them through PixInsight's subframe selector using a formula that I've discussed in a previous video. I'll just share it real quick here. This formula leads the subframe selector to do a pretty good job selecting subs based on differences in star counts per subframe, which can change due to atmospheric variances, as well as accepting and rejecting subs based on conditions such as variations in seeing, as well as guiding concerns. This is extremely important because you should only use the best subframes to produce an image. Imagine building a house, and you get good quality 2x4s to construct the walls. But if every now and then you have a rotted 2x4 and use it anyway, the strength imparted by all those 2x4s is going to be offset by those weak 2x4s and will ultimately weaken the entire house. Every subframe is like a 2x4 and the image is a house. If you let some poor winds in there, it's going to mess up the overall quality of the image. Now let's go into how to find the best subframe exposure time for your setup. Please bear in mind, this applies to deep sky objects. If you're shooting objects such as the sun or moon or planets, this would not be the right strategy. Pick a deep sky object of moderate brightness, say around magnitude 7. It should be a relatively flat DSO without bright areas that can easily blow out. In the northern hemisphere, one example that comes to mind for me is the Eastern Veil Nebula, NGC 6992. It has a magnitude of 7 and no extremely bright nor dim areas in it. Set your camera to its unity gain. Now I can't tell you what that is, that varies with every camera. Your camera's literature should either list it, or you can find it in the charts that portray the camera's performance in the areas of dynamic range and readout noise. The horizontal bars between the graphs portray gain. Find the place on the readout noise chart where the gain is above 0 and the readout noise suddenly drops from a higher number to a substantially lower number. And on the dynamic range chart where the dynamic range suddenly increases from a lower number to a substantially higher number. Right there is your unity gain. With my Player 1 Aries M camera, which is so far my absolute personal favorite, unity gain sits around 125. Just to be sure I'm a little bit into it, I typically shoot at 130. This will give you the benefits of some light amplification from gain. Though bear in mind, this doesn't make your sensor any more sensitive. Digital camera sensors always operate at maximum sensitivity. It just gives you some additional amplification of the signal from the photosites. And then, shoot some subframes. I suggest shooting the following exposures: 5 seconds, 15 seconds, 30 seconds, 60 seconds, 90 seconds, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, and 5 minutes. I honestly can't imagine a telescope and camera setup where you need to shoot more than 2 minutes, but this way has you safe and you can check everything. Then examine each of those subs. If you're using Nina, you can do this instantly as you shoot each one by examining the image as Nina shoots it using the auto stretch feature. Other applications to control your mountain telescope probably have a similar function. You can also save them and compare them side by side by opening them in something like PixInsight and using the screen transfer function to auto-stretch each subframe. You want there to be enough information in the image that you can easily discern its quality and tell if there have been guiding errors, if the image has been partially blocked by clouds or mist or ice in the sky, and you should easily be able to determine the structure of whatever DSO you are imaging, even if it is faint. If you can't, you need to increase your exposure time. So, inspect your subframes from the shortest time to the longest. And as soon as you find a subframe that allows you to easily visually discern the structure of the object, you have found your exposure time. Don't worry about whether or not your histogram shows black clipping on the left. As we talked about, that doesn't really matter with astrophotography. And be aware that you will see more noise in subframes with a short exposure time as compared to subframes with a long exposure time. Don't worry about that. When the subframes are stacked, all the information will be put together, yielding a master where noise is well managed. And don't worry about being super precise. You don't have to find the absolute minimum possible seconds to shoot. Get yourself in a good average ballpark where all the information will show up, shooting DSOs of typical magnitude, say about 5 to 8. And that will help you find your prime subframe exposure time, which you can then use to shoot almost every target. For myself, I find that when shooting through my Celestron C8, using luminance red, green, and blue filters, 60-second frame subs are ideal. If I am shooting an extreme high dynamic range deep sky object, and the only one I can think of offhand in the Northern Hemisphere is the Great Orion Nebula, I leave my exposure time at 60 seconds and change my gain from unity to zero. On the rare occasion that I shoot narrowband, I shoot subframe exposure times of 2 minutes and increase my gain to 200. And this is because narrowband filters let a lot less light pass through them than LRGB filters. So it takes a little more time and gain to make the structure stand out. I always want to keep my exposure times as short as possible. So when shooting narrowband filters, increasing the gain to 200 allows me to keep subframe exposure time short, but only very slightly lowers the camera's dynamic range while giving substantial photosite amplification of signal, allowing the signal to develop quicker with minimal impact on the camera's ability to record dynamic range. And I do suggest to use a similar strategy. However, you'll have to examine your camera's literature, particularly those readout noise and dynamic range charts, to find the best gain increase for your camera. But I suggest that you select the additional gain that puts your camera's dynamic range to back where it was just before you jumped up to unity gain. That'll give you a nice light amplification increase while conserving your camera's dynamic range. So let's examine some other myths regarding long versus short exposures, stacking, shooting under dark skies, and the potential or limitations of shooting shorter exposures. One of those myths is that when you're shooting under dark skies, you should shoot longer. Not in my experience. I've lived in the backwoods of the North my entire life, for a long time up near the Arctic even, in extremely low boreal areas. And I've tried long exposures and short exposures. And I'm telling you from years of hard experience, I would always go with short exposures. Long exposure times will give you a little bit more signal-to-noise ratio per sub, that's true, while running the risk of burning out certain objects within a DSO, suffering from guiding and mount errors, and the occasional wind, passing cloud or mist. Heck, I've even had an owl land one night on my telescope. And when you consider all of that together, it means that at the end of the night, you'll end up discarding more information if you shoot long subframe exposure times. And the final images that result from those long subframe exposure times will not be better. There is another myth that still floats around the astrophotography community that states that stacking lots of short subframe exposure time images will pull more detail than a single long exposure time image. And while this isn't exactly true, I can see how confusion can arise. Putting a lot of exposure time into a single subframe will certainly pull more information into it, giving it a better signal-to-noise ratio. And as the well depth of the camera sensor's individual pixel sites fill up, those pixels will show up as brighter and brighter. Again, think of your camera's photosites or pixels like cups, and the photons are like water molecules filling them up. The fuller, the brighter. So a subframe with a longer exposure time will appear as if it's captured more information because all of its information, including the dimmest information, will be brighter, more revealed. However, even if shooting short exposure time subframes, photons are still falling into the photosites of the camera. The photosites may not be as full, And so the information the photosites capture may show up in the final subframe as dimmer, but that information is still caught on the sensor and related in the subframe, even if the human eye can barely perceive it. But ultimately, that information will show up well as it is all put together in the final stacking procedure, producing a bright, crisp master. And a final myth that I'm aware of that seems to run contrary to some other myths, but that's the way myths are, aren't they? They're just based on nothing, so anybody can imagine anything. But a final myth that I'll address here is that if you shoot short subframe exposure time images, you won't be able to capture very dim objects. And to reply to that myth, let me show you two images. This is the region around NGC 4874. In this image are 2,815 galaxies up to 20 billion light years away, along with 28 quasars and 13 gravitationally lensed galaxies, not to mention a variety of other deep field objects. And some of these have magnitudes lower than 16. And I shot this deep field image using the very strategies described in this video, shooting subframes with just enough subframe exposure time that the subs could be sufficiently graded. And in my case, that 60-second subs at unity gain. And here is a personal favorite, two galaxies between 2.8 and 3.7 billion light years away, and a quasar 3 billion light years away. Quasar DWH M82-4 has a magnitude approaching 20. And galaxy SDSS J095-335 has a similar magnitude. So I guess with that, you can say that the myth that if you shoot short subframe exposure times, you won't be able to capture very dim objects is conclusively busted. So that's it. I firmly believe the best shooting strategy, a belief based on the hard evidence of years of outcomes, is to shoot the shortest subframe exposure time as possible. That is, subframes with just enough exposure time to reveal enough of an image that each subframe can be graded. This allows you to benefit from all those advantages of short subframe exposure times that we discussed earlier. And due to the magic of stacking, your image will nonetheless fill up with information as you add integration. And I know this runs contrary to what a lot of persons have said. Some of them have been very influential in the astrophotography community. But I think much of those old opinions are rooted in old ways of thinking. In the old days of astrophotography, back when we were using film, we had one shot per image. And in the early days of digital astrophotography, there were many other problems, such as read noise and the time it took to move a subframe from the camera to memory. But modern technology has moved on a long way, and with its changes, new best practices have evolved into the realm of astrophotography. Regardless, whether or not you use this strategy, have fun doing astrophotography and get out there and shoot the sky.